College football is sponsored by Ram Trucks, built to serve. It's a blackout night here in Stillwater, and the all-time great Barry Sanders will be inducted into the very new Hall of Honor. The Ring of Honor will include both he and Thurman Thomas. They were teammates in 86 when he was a freshman, and a brand spanking new statue outside T. Boone Pickens. Sooners have that one loss now. Cowboys can control things, moving towards Bedlam, and that makes tonight all the more important. TCU won the toss, deferred. Oklahoma State will receive, and Presley will let that one go through the end zone for the touchback, and we'll begin at the 25-yard line. And as much as we talk about the play of his counterpart, Spencer Sanders of late has been playing his best football. No doubt he's been up and down at times. He's been injured, but lately, really solid. 21 of 31, 182, a couple of touchdowns. The fade being his best pattern to Tay Martin, the transfer from Washington State. And on the ground, he's an extra running back. We all know about that. The best running back, though, is Jaylen Warren, who will be behind him.
Jaylen Warren is the key for him. He's the catalyst. If they get the run game established, then Spencer is going to be much, much more effective.
And a quick out pattern to Tay Martin right on cue. A negligible gain. 5 yards. It's Nook Bradford, 28. The weak side safety that's moved up, making the play. This is an offensive front. It's very good. Godlewski is the anchor, the center for this team. They rely heavily on him, flanked by Woodard Sills. And a tackle. The outstanding leader, Jaylen Warren, takes it again, moves ahead with a gain of 2. It'll be 3rd down and 3.
Yeah, Cole Birmingham and Jake Springfield, the left and right tackles respectively, are going to be key in this front stopping as well.
No question. 3rd down and 3. Little wide receiver screen action to Presley. His yards after catch, always a catalyst, and he's out for the first down. T.J. Carter, the safety, makes the tackle after a gain of 7.
Travis Hodges Tomlinson, number 1, came underneath it, had a shot to get a negative play, but again, it's that offensive line. They're mobile, Tim. They can move in space. Really nifty against those smaller guys.
Warren again. It's a Cowboy team that's got a lot of depth. TCU is banged up more so offensively than defensively. They have really played well up the middle. Terrell Cooper, 95, is a guy to keep your eyes on. D. Winters, the middle linebacker, does an outstanding job, number 13. And on the edges, previous Hodges Tomlinson played outstanding football a week ago in that win against Baylor. 2nd and 6. Play fake. Sanders with time. And he's got his man, Presley. It's another first down. Ball pops out. And it's TCU's.
They got it.
They've got it. Horned Frogs come away with the recovery. And it's LaKendrick Van Sant, the strong safety, that picks it up.
And, Timmy, this is beautiful throw by Spencer Sanders here. The timing was perfect. Inside camp technique, and he turns him the opposite direction. Beautiful read in real time, but you've got to complete the play. When the ball comes out like that, Brennan Presley has got to be able, with that wide position, hang on to that football, seat it properly, and get up and keep his arm and the ball across his breastplate instead of holding it high in the back like a chicken wing. When you get it up in the air like that, you lose a point of contact.
Hodges Tomlinson made the hit. We just pointed out how well he had played a week ago, and he gets the first turnover, forcing that fumble and the recovery by Van Zandt.
Now, if this young quarterback wants to hit this quick slant route right now, he's got it.
Underneath, he goes to Amari DiMarcato, the only scholarship running back available to this TCU team. It's Chandler Morris. What a journey it has been. A transfer from Oklahoma with a stopover after being an MVP and high school state champion at Highland Park. The son of Chad Morris.
He's got a vertical run.
And there it is. Bingo to Tay Barber.
And Tay, on that previous play, even though there's a flag down, Tim, Tay was in that exact same position. And Oklahoma State, Jim Knowles' defense didn't adjust to that. Tay Barber goes straight down the field on that vertical look with the bunch formation into the boundary.
ineligible receiver downfield. Number four, offense. It's a 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay second down.
So somebody was on the line of scrimmage. You could have seven across there, but that bunch formation, you had three consumed there, and then Trey was in that inside slot position between the hash and the numbers. Yeah. He can't go downfield.
He wants an explanation. He really does. Well, Jerry Kill wants an explanation.
There you go. See, here he is right now. But look, he's on the line of scrimmage, Tim. He's got to be off the ball. Someone on the other side has got to be off.
They called Tay Barber. They called number four on offense. Hard one to figure. Derek Anderson is our referee. Mark Marsden, our replay official. And here's DeMarcato again. Bolts out to the 43-yard line. Brock Martin, number nine, with the stop. The young man has been just so solid for so long. Redshirt senior, another one of those tough ones up the middle that have been so good for Jim Knowles' defense. Third down, a yard to go. Oklahoma State's third down defense, spectacular. Only 25% conversion rate for their opponents. And they go reverse to Quentin Johnson. That one almost popped. He got it into Cowboy territory to the 49-yard line.
If Jared Bernard Converse doesn't make that tackle, Tim, that would have been off to the races. Here's a look again at it on the reverse motion. You can see, again, Jared Bernard Converse gets that heel and clicks it there, and he goes down. But for that tackle, you're in trouble.
Dean Blandino, can you help me out with that ineligible receiver being Barber?
Barber was on the inside receiver. He was covered up by another receiver outside him, so he's ineligible and can't go downfield.
All right, there's DeMarcato. I think Jerry Kill, Dino, was concerned about number four being the guy, and here's the point you need to make.
So
right
what
here.
Dino's talking about, he says it's covered up. That inside guy, there's someone on top of him, or that the same level. That means covered up, and if he's covered up, he's ineligible. One of them has to come off the ball.
DeMarcato, again, he's about a half yard shy of the first down. We thank Dean for his input, as always. And a third down and less than a yard coming up for TCU. Well, if they can stay in third and short, they may be very potent tonight, Spence.
Yeah, that's one of the things that Jim Knowles doesn't want to have, those non-conflict scenarios where this aggressive defense that he has, which is lights out when they're playing and can pin their ears back, they don't want these short third and one.
That is Matisic, the tight end. He's got the first down. They will mark him at the 38-yard line. Brent Matisic normally plays tight end, a backup to Dominic D'Annunzio, who's also really a backup. They lost their lead gun at that position to injury weeks ago. You see all the running backs out. Evans was averaging 108 per game before he went out. Miller and Foster also not available. First and 10. Came off the edge for the first time. Oklahoma State able to get to Chandler Morris. And you see number 30, Colin Oliver, the freshman from Oklahoma City, the first to get there.
Yeah, he's from Edmond, Santa Fe. He's got good size on about 6'2", Tim, 225. Watch him come off the edge. He's playing nice leverage, comes down, takes on that block, sheds it, and then just squeezes. That's what they need to do with Chandler Morris. Keep him contained in the pocket because he can create.
Second and 15 after the loss of five. There they go, jet sweep the other way with Darius Davis.
Nice.
Darius Davis gets it down to the 29. He, again, just a yard shy of the first down. A pickup of 14. Malcolm Rodriguez with the stick.
Malcolm Rodriguez is really active, man, but he doesn't want to be in the situation, Tim. Big fullbacks help you. Watch the block here inside. You got the motion coming short to your way with the lead blocker in front of you. That makes it, as Brent Matisic did a wonderful job of getting out in front of that with the lead block.
Morris slipped and fell. That play was botched from the beginning because of the great penetration the Cowboys got. So after two conversions on third down, now they may have to try to go on fourth.
Well, I like the fact that they're in a position where they can still create run-pass conflict. They're platooning on the defensive side of the ball. Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, bringing in as many as four or five guys in between these plays to get the matchup that he wants. Here's that tight bunch formation. Madison coming back into the backfield now. You need him for protection. Now you got a short motion in the flat right now as an opportunity. Get him.
Morris, shallow cross. That's Quentin Johnson. He won't get there. How about the recognition of the men in black? That was led by Jason Taylor, the second, number 25. So the Cowboys will get it back on downs after surrendering the turnover. That's why they're number one in virtually every category in the Big 12. Cowboy up. Fox College Football is sponsored by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And by Ram Trucks, J.D. Power's number one brand in new vehicle quality. Time to get some Spencer Tillman takes on this one. Nothing, nothing here in the early going. Spencer, when the Cowboys have it, what are you looking for?
Well, when they've got a ball, they've got to stay balanced, Tim. That's the key, right? And when you do that, you keep this defense as active as they flow on their heels. And then you got to contain Jaylen Warren. That's really the key out here.
Speaking of Warren, check that Sanders. That was a mix-up. There was a bobble there, and Sanders wound up deciding to keep it as he decided he could not seed the ball properly to Jaylen.
They're going a little tempo here, Tim, try to catch him off guard and check their eye discipline.
Smart move by Sanders, given the bobble. Move. It really was some senior savvy, wasn't it?
Yep, and it's his opportunity for him to get a pre-snap read, and that's the reason why they're hurrying up now.
Did manage to gain three, so second and seven. He's just north and south. 6 yards on that carry.
Well, here's the previous play right here, Tim, and you can see the ball is up and it's out, man. I mean, it comes right back to Spencer, and he's sitting there saying, oh, look what I found. Could have easily gone the opposite direction.
On third and one.
Good boy, he's so strong.
He really does. Those pads are low and exactly where you'd want to be. Low man wins. That's a gain of four and a first down.
You and I were talking yesterday about how important he is to this offense, and the best analogy I can use to keep it within the conference. Remember Ramondre Stevenson, how important he was to Oklahoma last year against Texas Tech? And I think they hung like a 60 spot on him in that win, but they didn't get there until that run game showed up. This is what Jaylen Warren does for the Cowboys.
That's a busted play there. Sanders turned one way, Warren was going the other, and again, he ad-libs his way past midfield into TCU territory. Or now they may spot it back at the 48. I mean, clearly this was a, wait a minute.
Wait, it goes the wrong direction. I mean, again, Spencer settled down. He's done extremely well in the last five games. He's got seven touchdown passes to one interception, Tim. But this miscues early in the series right here has been interesting.
Second and six, swings it out to Jaylen Warren. He can come out of the backfield well and catch passes. You know, I'm reminded when I see that of Thurman Thomas, because he was so good at coming out of the backfield. We're honoring Barry Sanders going into the Ring of Honor, but Thurman was much more accessible in the passing game when he played with Mike Gundy. Deep to Presley. Oh, right between his hands. Well defended by Carter, but that was catchable. That could have very easily been a touchdown.
Yeah, TJ Carter, man, the weak safety, Tim, really came in. He's a captain this week, by the way, out of Nashville, Tennessee. Does a wonderful job, even though he doesn't identify the ball.
Hey, wait a minute.
He's in close proximity.
Look at this.
He got that left hand on the shoulder, didn't he? Yeah.
He did.
Yep.
That was a heck of a defensive play. I thought for a moment the ball had gone through his hands. Carter disrupted that. Mm-hmm. He may have gotten there a little early, too, but he definitely disrupted it. Second and 10. Swing it out again. John Paul Richardson. That's a first down.
Tell you right now, you know, as great a plays he made on the previous play, talking about TJ Carter, the weak safety, he's got to come from that inside position. This little jet motion or any type of sift motion coming his way, he needs to get on top of that. In other words, get parallel with that guy, because the speed is beating him to the edge. He's got to play inside and out. This is one of the hallmarks of a Gary Patterson type defense, speed. Undersized guys can't get beat that way. Nice job.
Yes, indeed. And he just has to unload it. That pressure off the corner from Van Zandt, the strong safety. And Sanders was very fortunate just to get rid of it. Speaking of Gary Patterson, in talking with the defensive people, Chad Glasgow, now running this defense, he said that playing a team like Oklahoma State, Spencer, after Baylor, plays a little bit well for them. They think that this is a good opponent to have in the aftermath of playing a power team like Baylor a week ago.
Well, undersized against those bigger physical teams, this is more in their wheelhouse. Let's see how they continue to hold up.
Reverse action.
Oh, they got a good play here.
That's Blaine Green. Blaine Green, seeing Green.
Out of bounds at the four.
Josh Foster, the strong safety, didn't have a chance. And number 15 immediately got put in his hip pocket, chasing down Green. And he's Green with envy here, trying to get back. Look at the motion, action away, and then coming back. Got all of those fast, athletic guys, smallish, running one direction. He comes back the other.
There goes Warren, Jalen Warren, to the goal line. Yeah, they all bit, didn't they, on that reverse action. And it enabled Blaine Green to make the big play. But Warren now has it down to the one. Gotta figure he gets it again.
Don't you?
Yep. Runs into his own guy, but he's there. Touchdown. Well, there may be a few hiccups in that drive. A bobble here, a bobble there, and then Bryson Green actually runs into, or Blaine Green, I beg your pardon, runs into Jalen right here. But, by the way, that's just like another defender to him.
Yeah, Blaine's got to get on his high horse, man, and get out there because, again, you can't sift block that. You can't size the guy up when you're trying to run inside zone or power.
Tanner Brown with the extra point. A bootleg action screen to get this thing going to John Paul Richardson, and then shortly thereafter, it was time for Jalen to take over. A little power football, Keith. Power football. Above and Beyond, sponsored by Jersey Mike's, a sub above. And, yeah, he was above and beyond with Barry Sanders.
Tim lit fuse, racing to a point to explode right there now.
And the first Heisman winner to get it by virtue of cable television's evolution into college football. And I'll explain that a little bit later. See the scoring drive. 11 plays, 68 yards. Darius Davis awaits this. Calls for a fair catch. It's actually Quincy Brown. Davis was back there with him, but Brown called for the fair catch. And we've got a timeout. Horned Frogs are just trying to keep up. You don't want to get roped in Stillwater. Built for Success is presented by Rocket Mortgage. For the playbook on home loans, Rocket can. And how about this, Spencer?
Yeah,
how good is this defense?
Take a look at this right here. First. This is in the conference, right?
Yeah.
Big 12 rankings him number one in all these categories. And here's the thing about it. They're not relying on the throw game as a principal. Jalen Warren is anchoring this team in the run game.
They are. They're playing complementary football. DeMarcado in the pistol formation behind his quarterback, Tanner Morris.
Nice.
And there he goes. Takes two or three bumps to get him to the turf. He's down at the 35-yard line. That is enough to move the sticks. Christian Holmes with the tackle.
Yeah, give him credit. I'm talking about Doug Meacham, the offensive coordinator. They're going to go pace and tempo a little bit here, working the run game to push this down the field. We know he's an air raid guy in the strictest sense of the definition.
Underneath, tight end guy right up the middle. And look at D'Annunzio, Dominique. Can D'Annunzio inside the 20. He lumbers to the 16. Man.
Tim, it's all about influence. You take care of your business. You get a two for one. You get a two for one out of D'Annunzio, who had a touchdown last week in the comeback. Wonderful job of doubling up, getting a block, and then explosive plays on the back end.
DeMarcado in the back.
Plenty of time. Nice job releasing.
Oh, look at that move by Morris just to get to the 20. Nice adjustment, and again, the previous play to D'Annunzio, this was well set up.
Well, you can see 84 right here, Tim, off the ball, and again, he sets, bam, slams, and then releases, right? Inside, and I love the fact that his awareness is not going to cover himself. That means understand it's zone behind you. There's no man coverage, so just settle down there and be a static target so your quarterback can see it.
That was some stiff arm he gave Jason Taylor. Did you see that?
That's a great slam. Great call by Doug Meacham there.
Second down, 11. Meacham, by the way, the offensive coordinator, was a wide receiver here at Oklahoma State when Gundy played. Shallow cross, and it's Darius Davis. Not much that time. They run sideline to sideline, that defense, as well as any team you'll see. No gain. It was Thomas Harper, 13, the first to get there.
Darius did a wonderful job on that shallow crossing route. Again, it was a zone-type coverage with a man under concept. And all that means is the shell over the top, the two safeties are playing zone. But the men underneath that are responsible for individual parties. They doubled up on Davis in that one time right there. Did a nice job of getting what he could out of that.
Actually lost a yard officially. Third and 11.
I love the soft side, the right side of this front that TCU has. They can run the ball there, or the quick slant is there right now, unless you got number nine dropping in the zone. You got a big time play.
Clinton Johnson is his go-to guy. Morris in trouble and sacked. Colby Harvell Peel, number 31. A senior from College Station.
Yeah, Quentin Johnson, I think, could have read that and what they call a sight adjustment with off coverage on that ball, and it was there, Tim. But again, you can see Morse sees this ball, but the pressure comes from depth. And once that back misses him, you got a busted assignment there by your back and your tackle. They've got to cooperate with one another, and you always leave the little guy for the back. And then if they squeeze you down, if you're the tackle, you got to slide down. Whether it's Easy or Brandon Coleman, the left guard, those guys have got to squeeze that.
Griffin Kill will try from 44. And the young man comes through for them to get some points. He had one block last week. Had one hit the upright. No need for the iron to be kind, the upright, or the crossbar.
That stiffy was kind.
Yeah. TCU is on the board. Fox College Football is sponsored by Pacific Life. More than 150 years strong. Protect what matters most. There's the library. Uh-huh. I ventured past it a couple of times. Homecoming week.
Come on, Tim. You know you burn the midnight oil in Louisiana, Monroe.
I generally do the audio books. That's what I do. 7-3 our score after the 44-yard field goal. Brennan Presley is back deep, awaiting this kick. Yes, he is. Look out. Quality return, too.
Love that.
You can get it beyond the 30-yard line. You're going to love that. Well, listen, they had a 46-yard connection to D'Annunzio in that drive for TCU. But, Spencer?
That's about it, man.
What did the defense do after that? Well, the defense did this. The next three plays, minus one, minus one, minus six.
Well, so that
and that's what they do. Yeah, that's what they do when they're backed up. They're a great red zone defense.
Well, one of the things that Jim Knowles has done, he's got speed kind of similar to what this TCU defense is orchestrated like. But these guys are physical as well as fast. I love the way that they are assignment sound, Tim. They're tough guys, they're physical, and they're available.
Wide receiver screen, and it's Willie well-wed by C.J. Caesar, number nine. Presley stopped in his tracks.
He's from your neck of the woods, Monroe, Louisiana, Timmy. Watch him come underneath this coverage and goes right through the guy. That's how you play upfield with leverage.
Richwood High School in Monroe.
Mm-hmm.
Sanders is on the loose. Inside or outside the 40 to the 43. And another first down. Look, Bradford with the tackle.
Love how Sanders protects himself again. You got to take a look at it, protect yourself. Maybe a little helmet to helmet there. Just a little side. I think you let that thing slide.
Yep.
Again, but guys got to learn to keep their head up, man. That's what it's all about, the safety of the players. And, you know, it's baked in almost from the time you're kids. But it's been around long enough, the rule has, that you can keep your head up. You can't hit what you can't see.
First down. Warren
nice
cuts
read.
It back. Look at that cutback. Jaylen Warren. Oh, you, Jaylen. He knows Barry Sanders is in the building.
And he took Luke Bradford and put him in his back pocket, number 28, the safety. Watch this read inside right here. It's an inside zone, but he's stretching to the outside. Then he comes back underneath and then makes one guy miss. And then watch him put Nook in his hip pocket. 28's trying to get there, Tim. He has to grab him by the pants and bring him back. But he feels the pressure and squeeze and sifts to the outside to get more yardage out of it.
Quick slant, incomplete. Intended for Jaden Bray, 85. This is a freshman they're really high on out of Norman, Oklahoma. He's the team's third leading receiver with 16 grabs, but has had no catches in the last couple of games. A talented high school running back, ran for nearly 1,500 yards and 23 touchdowns as a senior. Norman, Oklahoma, a stud wide receiver. Sanders again.
Got all he put out of that, man. Sanders did a wonderful job of getting to the edge. Pressure brought him there and just showed you he's got a little foot speed, too.
Time winding down. No gain there, so it'll be third and 10. Well, TCU's defense looking to do what Oklahoma State did once backed up into the red zone.
I look at the maturity here on Sanders. He's really taking care of the ball exceptionally well. He has gone on a natural kind of positive arc upwards in terms of his progression and maturity as a quarterback.
Desmond Jackson is into the game. Nice. They go with an out pattern. It's caught by Brennan Presley. T.J. Carter right there with him.
Yeah, T.J. was off coverage playing inside out. In other words, the sideline wasn't his helper on that play.
Spencer, it'll be fourth and a little over a yard when we come back.
Oh,
Sugar.
Doctor.
For the start of the second quarter. Fox College Football is sponsored by Ram Trucks, built to serve. And a free timeout with the end of the quarter. Oklahoma State had plenty of time to figure out what they want to do here.
Gutsy call here, Tim, going for it. Twins look in the field. Let's see if they come back to this side.
Warren the setback. 4-for-9 on fourth down conversions. Yes. There he goes. He's in there. It's touchdown.
Casey Dunn, the offensive coordinator, gets a Twins look to the short side of the field technically, but only by a little bit to kind of get the numbers to his advantage and goes right back inside to his heavy gun. We said at the top of the show, Jaylen Warren, everything begins and ends with him. He is a catalytic player to their throw game, but clearly in the red zone.
Spencer, I want you to think back in the NFL to the days of the Ravens when Brian Billick was the coach.
I know where you're going.
Jamal Lewis was his running back. Dilfer was his quarterback.
Shannon Sharp, tight end.
Yeah, he decided to play small ball and let his defense win.
Yep.
That's what Oklahoma State is, the college version of that Ravens team, in my opinion. Yeah,
credit Mike Gundy for doing that. A lot of coaches would have the ability to do that from an Eagles standpoint. But again, when you got a runner like this, Timmy, you've got to acquiesce and understand. There's been a fundamental shift in this conference. We talked about it, and then Sanders has been part of that. He said, hey, I want that, man. Just keep force-feeding me, baby. I'm hungry.
Wanted some offensive linemen to come in there and get him a little bit of a hug. He now has 995 yards rushing this season, 67 tonight with two touchdowns.
Here's the thing. They're stealing possessions away from the prolific offense of Texas Christian that we saw last week. TCU had prolific numbers from this first-time starter quarterback. And as a result of that, you were expecting the same thing today, but they have flipped the script. Jim Knowles, the easy learn and quick adoption from his players, particularly those guys at the linebacker position, which is the heart and soul of what they do, read and reacting, has kept this quarterback, Chandler Morris, down to a low roar.
Well, remember this. They had that turnover on their opening drive and were really moving it at that point. Mm-hmm. And they've not been in sync since then. Let's meet Chandler Morris. The best debut I've ever witnessed in my years of covering college football. He was a state champion, an MVP, an Oklahoma find, and a TCU transfer portal maneuver. And boy, did it pay dividends. Last night, our conversation with him was just outstanding, and we talked to his dad about an hour before game time, right about the time he was pulling into the parking lot. And look at that. Most total yards by a freshman. Passed some serious competition there. When you mentioned C.J. Stroud of Ohio State, he had himself a day in Columbus this afternoon. DeMarcado gets four on first down. This is a very important drive for Chandler and for his Horned Frogs.
It really is, Tim. I want to see them establish their run game so that they can keep this defense honest, and we can see some of the decision making that we saw last week in the upset win over Baylor. Because I think Forrest is one of the, I think because of his pedigree, his father, he's a gym rat. All of that sets him up to be far mature than his years would suggest. He's a special kid, to be sure.
Second and six.
Nice. Got to get it out.
Probably needed a little more air underneath that one for Quincy Brown. It falls incomplete. Third and six coming up.
Yeah, and Doug can help him out, too. The offensive coordinator, Doug Meacham, can give him some help. That throw is a lot more difficult than you think. From a moving target away from you, it's tough sometimes to gauge how much you need to put on it. That comes with repetition.
Two for four on third down so far.
Trips to the field. Let's see if he takes advantage of that inside route. Straight man with a single high safety for Oklahoma State. Man on it.
He's made the change, recognize it now. Got a hot route, and it's incomplete. Davis was hot after he made the adjustment, but to no avail, and the Cowboys get another three and out.
Well, OSU did a wonderful job with their defense. Again, you can get a little bit short arm if you're Darius Davis working underneath when you see that guy. Even though the ball gets tipped here out of his hand, Tim, wonderful job.
Yeah.
It actually comes off the helmet of one. Comes off the helmet here. You can see
Tyler Lacy.
Tyler Lacy and then Dominic Richardson. Let me see who else was in there.
Brock Martin.
Doc Martin was in there as well. Bunch of guys in there.
Jordy Cindy will put it away. And Presley cuts it back up. Good coverage there by TCU. That's Darius Davis down to make the play. 49-yard boot. A 6-yard return. Everything going smoothly in Stillwater so far. Pacific Life game summary sponsored by Pacific Life. More than 150 years strong. Pistol Pete's seen his club do what they want to do defensively. And from an offensive standpoint, they've really doubled up on TCU. The Horned Frogs now, from a defensive standpoint, now in a must-stop position.
Those total yards telling, man. 178, 91. That's not anywhere close to the production we saw last week.
Desmond Jackson, who's been out, he and L.D. Brown were lost early in that backfield, is in the game. They play fake to him, and that pass is caught. There goes Bryson Green. He's to midfield.
Travis Hodges Tomlinson was defending on the back end of that. He had his hand up in the air. But again, just a wonderful job. Man coverage, off coverage. He squats on it and then drives on this ball here. The ball is placed exactly where it needed to be.
Bradford with the saving tackle. Sanders in trouble, has to unload it.
Smart move.
Here's that prior play again. And not only the catch, but what he can do after contact.
Yeah, you can see Hodges Tomlinson there was on his backside and trying to get him a little shoulder. You got to bring more than that. He's got such range and great size. Spins out of that and gets extra yardage.
Spencer, did D. Winters actually tip that ball?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it did.
And yet he was able to make the adjustment and make the catch. Second and 10. Desmond Jackson stays in the game, number 27, in the backfield.
A pistol now.
And he'll tote it. Ahead for two, maybe three, and the aforementioned D. Winters from Brenham, Texas, leading this team in tackles with 60, 43 solo, 4.5 tackles for losses. He's a stud.
Yeah, he's built low to the ground, Tim. Look at him finish. That's how you finish, man, driving forward.
So third and long, third down and 7. Sanders under pressure.
Nice footwork.
Incomplete. Outstanding coverage by Hodges Tomlinson.
Yeah, nice footwork by Spencer Sanders, but also better on the back end defending Hodges Tomlinson does a wonderful job of bouncing back from the previous play where he gets beaten. He shows you the pressure. Nice footwork by Spencer stepping up and delivering just what he needed on that ball. It was high, placed about as best as it could be placed. Tomlinson sets inside, squats, and then butts the guy up and redirects him. Maybe got that left hand in there a little bit early, but bottom line is that was wonderful coverage there by Tomlinson Hodges.
I like the no call. Let him play.
Yep.
Well, Darius Davis is back deep. Incredible start, really, for Oklahoma State, giving up less than a yard average defending punt returns.
Great.
They've been outstanding. And a fair catch here. Their 0.64 average defending punt returns is second best in the country. You got to be great at all three levels. And this team is. Fox College Football is sponsored by Honda and by Liberty Mutual Insurance. Only pay for what you need. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman in Stillwater, Oklahoma. Big sequence coming up here for the former Cowboy as a player, now OC, and a good one, a real good one at TCU.
What they need right now are some explosive plays, and they need to get the ball downfield, but they're in a precarious spot, backed up. Let's see what Doug Meacham dials up.
We should mention that Max Duggan is available tonight if need be, but this is really right now Chandler Morris's team.
Love that.
There's a nice run by DeMarcado to give him some better field position out to the 21-yard line. Gundy and Meacham having a little conversation, the former teammates, before this one got underway. Old friends.
Oh, yeah. That's air raid right there. One-on-one, man. Both of them have had to adapt and adopt new approaches. There they are in 87.
There they are. You see, he was an O-lineman that spent a little time as a tight end to go with it in his time here back in the mid-80s. He was actually on the field with Barry Sanders in 86, Spence, when I called my first Cowboys game against Missouri on a Thursday night in December to close out the year. That's Devin Harper making the tackle of Imara DeMarcado. Hard to believe that was 35 years ago.
Wonderful job there by Thomas coming up. Thomas Harper, number 13, came from that safety position as we look at both those coaches right there. And there's a lot of intellectual property in those two minds.
Spencer, I recall it was an open-air press box back then, and I got stuck to the bleachers.
Was it that
It was
cold?
An icy cold night. Yes, my rear end was stuck. DeMarcado out the 35 to the 38-yard line. Malcolm Rodriguez the tackle, so they go a little old school. Get that power football working here.
How about that? Direct snap, isolation, eyes downfield. Wonderful job, crossover step, getting vertical. I love those base plays, man, because they're easy to read, positive yards, and they really can set up some quick throws. A little eye discipline test here.
Yeah, how about that?
Yep.
That's DeMarcado again. Harper making the stop. A lot of jitterbugging going on in that formation. Blair Conright, it was like he was in a GM testing plant.
Yeah, and Sean Michael Flanagan, number 18, the safety took a big hit. DeMarcado did a wonderful job of just getting low. The old saying, low man wins. That's how you run with leverage and finish. 18 didn't have a chance. Nice physical run.
I don't know that I've ever seen that much motion in the backfield by a wide receiver before play.
There's a design to it.
Yeah, he's looking long down the sideline. A near one-handed grab by Quentin Johnson. Boy, he almost had that one. And I'm not sure that if he had laid out for it, Spencer, he would have reeled it in. Can't throw it any better.
Pressure came, Tim, and it was just a great throw, number one. Again, the ball was up, sided, had to try to get that right hand on it, couldn't bring it in. That's just great defensive work, Tim, on the back end.
Yeah, the left arm was blocked out. You're absolutely right, partner. Jarrett Bernard Converse, great cover corner, senior from Shreveport, Louisiana. Try it again, and it's overthrown. And his man was wide open. open. That was Blake Noel, 87. Redshirt freshman.
That's what happens when you get the inside run game working, at least respecting it. Y seam becomes open right on those hash marks upfield. Nice job of delivering it. Morris has got the arm to do it. Nice touch.
Oh.
Just beyond the outstretched arms. I think you got to catch that one, man.
I agree.
You got to make that play. You got a guy bailing out underneath. A crossing route, a switch route. That combination really allowed Y to get vertical without anyone being in the immediate area.
Yeah, if he lays out for that one, I think he grabs it. Mm-hmm. Jordy Sandy goes end over end with this boot. Presley takes it at the 16. 43 yards, no return. These defenses making it hard for the opposition. Look in her eye. Something you need to know about Jerry Kill, if you didn't already know, is that he's not some CEO. He's an offensive mind. He came in because Gary Patterson wanted him to help with his offense. And he's talking to Chandler Morris there. You also saw Max Duggan in on the conversation. They did convert a couple of third downs, Spencer, with the ground game, but missed a couple of big opportunities in the passing game.
He's certainly schooled in the run game, but I think the reason why he was brought here was to manage the relationship between, at the time, two White Hawk coordinators.
Wonderful defensive play. Tay Martin, the intended receiver, and C.J. Caesar, step for step, made the play.
Tim, there's no replacement for foot speed. Again, a tandem look to the field. Martin, vertical, gets past Caesar, and Caesar recovers nicely. Doesn't even get his head around, but that's what speed does.
Yep.
Speed is a great neutralizer to put that defender in a position to make that pass incomplete.
Some of the fans don't like it, but Spencer,
no, it's great.
To the point about a pass interference, I love the consistency with this crew right here. They're allowing a lot to go on.
We have 19 flags flying around.
Exactly.
Sure.
We had six flags in succession in Fort Worth last week. Jalen Warren again gets it out for seven, so that'll set up third and three.
Now, for all the good things we said about Jalen Warren, for you youngsters out there, Pop Warner, watching this, never cut on your inside foot. When you're trying to go the opposite direction, your outside foot needs to be under you or wider than your right shoulder. So just keep the foot under. When you cross over like that, Barry Sanders was the best at it in the world. Unless you're built like he is, man, that guy could get squat and remain balanced. And he's like a panther, man.
He's gone over 1,000 yards on the year with that run. There's the swing to Tay Martin, and he's got it up to the 31, stopped by Hodges Tomlinson. That, by the way, is the nephew of LaDainian Tomlinson.
Yep. Showing you great man-to-man coverage, really confident. When you see a guy that's willing to play press coverage like that, and I love the fact that he finishes with physicality, Tim. At the point, he's got something special about him. I like him. They're going after him, though. They're testing him.
First and 10 from the 32.
Nice read.
Warren again. I mean, just feed and fan him. Let him tote it all he wants. T.J. Carter with the stop. He only got 16 carries last week against West Virginia. Not many plays for either team in that game.
Yeah, he's such an instinctive runner here. The stretch play, and despite the fact that his tackle gets shedded right there, he does a wonderful job of getting the last 3 or 4 yards with that stiff arm to get additional yards on top of the nice physical run.
He becomes the 25th Oklahoma State running back to get over 1,000 in a single season. Stays with it. Stopped at the 43 by Dylan Horton, who had such a big day last week. One of the captains of this TCU team that they've called upon to help them through this transition with Gary Patterson gone, and in fact helped select this week's captains for tonight's game.
Yeah, a senior out of Frisco, Texas, and he does a wonderful job at that right defensive end position as Coach Kill looks on. And Kill has done a wonderful job of really situationally managing this team where it was, and that's how he got him to play at a high level. And it's a wonderful job. Hopefully they'll turn things around. We can unpack it a little bit.
Second and 9. A dangerous throw, but a completed one to Brennan Presley.
Yeah, the one thing that's becoming clear to me right now is Travis Hodges Tomlinson is they're going after him. They think that they've got something there, man coverage there or zone, and that was a zone coverage look there with Hollinson looking inside. They think they've got something that they can exploit.
Sanders Again, a quality ad lib on the part of the young man. It's like an extra running back. D. Winters with the stop. Oklahoma State, after a few bobbles on what was a drive that led to their first touchdown, really kicking into another gear.
And they're still in possessions away from the Horned Frogs, and that's the biggest damage here.
Jackson. Fresh legs for the young man that's been out.
Physical.
He's ready to go. Like a rugby scrum. And another first down.
Early whistles there, man. They let him fight. I love this. And here's the thing that you're seeing here. Oklahoma State dominating the line of scrimmage, Tim. Earl Burquette and all of those guys up front. Corey Bethany. Sean Mathis, number 32. And then you mentioned Dylan Horton a moment ago. Those guys are getting handled on this drive now.
That was a gain of 8 for Jackson. Young man out of El Dorado, Arkansas. Hutchinson Community College, where they've put a lot of Division I talent out. There he goes again.
These are just basic inside zone physical reads. And man, you just got to put your hat on and show up. And one thing about Oklahoma State, they have totally changed their identity, man. It's not four verts, stretching the field vertical to make plays. They're going to set up this run game, make you honor it, put your numbers down, then they'll take their shots.
Jackson again.
Look at this. This is wonderful.
He'll be about 2.5 yards shy of the first down. O'Shawn Mathis, an outstanding defender, led the Big 12, was ranked 12th nationally in sacks per game a year ago. He's durable, too. Started every game the last 2 years. Third, and we'll call it 2.5.
Just saw a shot of Mike Gundy there. Give him credit, Tim, for staying with this approach to the game. The run game is paramount.
Presley in motion. Warren. He was met at the point of attack that time. Falling forward, but I believe he's shy of the first down.
And Josh Foster got in at that safety position. Really brought the leather, man. They're popping inside there. Burquette and company.
They're going to give him the first down.
Him, yeah.
Now that's a quality spot right there. I don't know that he got there. Now they want a timeout. TCU's going crazy over there, and I think that the reason is because they don't like that spot at all.
Well, that's what Coach Kill does. He makes those game day decisions.
Media timeout.
He wants to give them time for Mark Marsden, the replay official, to take a look at it. Fox College Football is sponsored by T-Mobile. America's largest, fastest, and most reliable 5G network, and by Allstate. Save money like a champion with Allstate. Well, Spencer, they decided during the timeout, as we projected, to take a look at this. Again, the line to make is inside that white line at the 5-yard line. And to me, he didn't
get
there.
After further review, the runner was down short of the line to gain at the 5.5-yard line. It'll be 4th and a half for Oklahoma State.
Well, that was a very wise timeout by Jerry Kill.
That's what he does. I mean, he told us yesterday that, look, he believes that when you're asked to do too much in that head coaching position, you miss opportunities like that to help your team. And in today's age, man, you need to be able to have that singleness of purpose, and that's what he does as a head coach. That's part of his mission. Wonderful job challenging that.
Well, that makes this all the more important for his defense. See if they can rise up here and get a stop. Certainly understand why the Cowboys would go for it here. 0 for 1 tonight on 4th downs. Warren is back in the backfield.
At the inside zone, right over the center.
I think he got there.
Yep.
First down. I tell you, this young guy is really something special.
Tim, the science behind running effectively is really simple. You look where the soft spots are in the front and attack it. And if you don't feel like you have a physical matchup there to win it, you rely on your running back. And if you've got a guy like Jaylen Warren, you flip that coin and you give it to him anyway. He's going to win most battles.
Oklahoma State 2 for 2 on 4th. Play fake, Sanders, And the marker comes down late. I think they're going to tag Caesar for the PI.
CJ Caesar was out there, number 9, again, the junior from your neck of the woods, Tim. He's squatting. He's got his eyes peeking inside, and I don't think he got nervous, but he did hold.
Yes,
there's
no
question about that.
Yep.
No question. He held on that one, and Presley was trying to get away on his outcut back to the outside and was held.
Well, if he doesn't hold, it's
number 9,
touchdown.
Defense.
So.
Ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
Well, there's only one defense to that move is to be camped on the outside edge of Presley in that case, and that's just a decision you got to make before the route is run. Just like he is right now. You play the outside shoulder. Don't give him the outside.
Jaylen Warren, a touchdown. His third touchdown tonight. 10th. Of the season.
This is all about physical blocking up front, and of course, Warren doing his job. I mean, all of these guys right up front, Timmy, Springfield, Woodard, Josh Seals, Birmingham, all of them out physically the Horned Frog, smaller in size, just moving them and allowing this back, who is the catalyst for this team, Jaylen Warren, to get in for yet another score.
Cole Birmingham, the redshirt sophomore out of Katy, Texas, has some future. But Sills and Godlewski, the center, some of the seniors, some of them 5-year and super seniors, making a difference. We don't know what this conversation is about. May have picked up the flag. Let's see. Or they're going to exercise the penalty on the kickoff. He's waiting for word from Gundy.
The result of the play is a touchdown. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 32 of the defense. This is number 32's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of the game, counted towards disqualification. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
Oh, Sean Mathis getting a little bit frustrated, Tim, yeah. And that's basically all that is. Yeah. Guys getting pushed around a little bit, to be honest with you, a lot tonight, and temper's flaring a little bit.
He raised up his hands and said, yeah, I got it. I'm okay with that. I won't do it again. Tanner Brown with the extra point. 13 plays, 84 yards, over 5.5 minutes off the clock. That is the new Cowboy football. Cowboys. 21-3 our score. Oklahoma State dominating really since the late stages of the first quarter and now all of the second, Spencer, and they'll exercise the 15 yards here for the kick. Here's what happened with O'Shawn Mathis losing his cool there.
Yeah, just getting a little bit physical, pushing guys around, Timmy. And again, when you get handled like that, you've got to be able to contain yourself. And it's really part of the discipline part of the game. Football will teach you that, but he's got to do a better job of just containing his emotions.
This is where the rubber meets the road now for Chandler Morris. And, you know, it's not that he's had a horrible night. They just haven't made the plays that they made a week ago. He's had some receivers open, overshot a couple, but you could also say, as you did, Spencer, you got to make some of these catches when you're that wide open.
Well, I think when the opportunities have come to pass the ball, it's usually as a result of an effective running attack, and that's what we've not seen and that we saw last week. He had 70 yards rushing himself. Those numbers don't exist tonight, and as a result, the overall success of the offense is not going to exist. We featured on his passing numbers, but the 70 yards to the ground, man, that helped him. It's huge.
No question. Pressure again, lets it go underneath, and it's caught by Tay Barber, but he's stopped in his tracks behind the line of scrimmage.
And the thing is, under duress and pressure once again, that's the consistent thing that you see. Pressure in his face affects his execution and efficiency.
They actually did give him 2 yards of forward progress. Second down and 8. See if they can get the tight end involved again. Their biggest play was to DeNunzio. Looking in that direction, goes underneath. And that is a Monty Watkins, a converted cornerback, playing for the first time at running back tonight. And the freshman from Houston, Texas, is ahead for a first down. Much, much needed.
Watkins came in at the right time and show you that athleticism. Doug Meacham wants to get that drive concept in. I mean, I'm not, hopefully not giving their signals, but bottom line, you look for a pass opportunity now. He wants to take a shot.
Watkins remains the setback. Well, you talk about going down the depth chart. They've done that at that position, haven't they? They've got one other that they can turn to. Darrell Reynolds is a walk-on. They got to give DeMarcado a little bit of a blow. Previous play, here it is.
You can see it right here in the backfield. Tim does a nice job faking the inside read the zone, but the screen, he slips out, gets upfield, and gets these explosive plays and shows you that ex-running back vision that he has to get vertical and get some extra yards. They need to take a shot down the field, man.
DeMarcado has come back into the game for Watkins.
There you go.
I believe that time Quentin Johnson had more than just a little bit of contact to deal with. I mean, he was absolutely held and no flag. I mean, Jarek Bernard Converse had him right around the waist, the arm. He's pulling his shirt.
Yeah, I mean, he had both hands, the right and the left arm. And those white shirts, man, you got to be able to see it. You know that that hand against that shirt is obvious. And Coach Kill probably saw the same thing that we saw. He should have got a flag on that one and didn't.
I mean, I'm okay with letting it go, but to a point, you see the jersey being pulled. You got to throw the little yellow hanky. Third and 10. Morris again. Knocked out by Rodriguez, and the ball goes out of bounds at the 47.
Yeah, you talk about flow reading, reacting. The inside linebacker pair, Malcolm Rodriguez, number 20, and his battery mate, Devin Harper, 16. Man, when they run and chase, let me show you, they affect the quarterback, balls out of your hands, and they leave an indelible mark on the mind of the, whether it's a quarterback in this case or a running back or a receiver, these guys are all over the place.
Jordy Sandy, the Australian, back into the game to punt it away. So a loss of four on that third down play. Presley back deep. He's waiting inside his 10. And he takes the fair catch at the 11. 39-yard boot. Monday on FS1, it's hoop season. Will the iron be kind? The Gavitt tip-off games begin as two elite conferences go head-to-head. First, number 11, Illinois faces Marquette. Then Providence takes on Wisconsin. Catch all the action Monday, starting at 7 Eastern on FS1 and the Fox Sports app.
Timmy, who you liking? I know it's early, but looks like contenders early on.
Well, UCLA and Villanova played last night, and they're both very strong contenders. Bruins have everybody back from a Final Four team. And in the Big East, Villanova, you got to count on, and I certainly think they're going to get pushed by UConn this year. The Huskies may be the team that is hardwired to give them a tough time. And the Flying Illini are outstanding in the Big Ten. The Buckeyes of Michigan would be good, too. Warren with a flag down. He's down at the 14. TCU hoping to get a stop and one more opportunity before the break.
They need something positive to go in this
offside
break.
Number 91, defense. 5-yard penalty. Replay first down.
Well, that won't help.
Yeah. You know, Patrick Jenkins, again, all these guys are up front are trying to make plays, and they're platooning, getting in there, just getting frustrated right now. We saw earlier O'Shawn Mathis caught for the unsportsmanlike conduct. These guys getting pushed around a little bit, showing some lack of discipline.
Sanders gets it out to Tay Martin. And the Wazoo transfer goes out of bounds.
Has a flag again. Yeah.
T.J. Carter will get tagged. They had him out of bounds, and then when you throw him the way he threw him, you're going to get that flag. There's some woofing going on, but quickly Mike Gundy gets to his team and says, all right, that's enough.
Hodges Tomlinson in off coverage here, and he drives on this ball. They've been working on him. You know, I think he's kind of getting a little bit concerned about his capacity to cover in that, because he's got a big cushion and doesn't finish and drive on him like you're used to seeing him do. You know, he usually will
after
run
play,
through a receiver in that situation.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 7 of the defense. 15 yards added to the end of the run, first down.
Well, that's a 32-yard net gain. The last thing TCU needed here, because now the Cowboys are in a position to hit them with a devastating blow and a score before the break. Jaylen Warren sets up in the pistol behind his quarterback.
If he gets protection, Tim, they've got a shot in the center of the field if they bend this over route by the slot guy.
Safety valve, Presley. Bumped out at the 46-yard line.
So many opportunities right here to take advantage, unfortunately, of this back end for the Horned Frogs. Right now they're vulnerable because they're playing like a two-deep shell, and the field is wide open. Single high safety now. They've come out of it, concerned about the run, but that's not really what the threat is.
Thought it was interesting talking to Mike Gundy in our conversation yesterday, asking him about TCU. He said, you know, the defensive principles were unchanged in his mind. That looked like a Gary Patterson defense. Looking long and taking a shot, it's incomplete. That was Bryson Green, and C.J. Caesar was right there with him.
Throwing that one up against man coverage. And again, I just think the physicality and the decision-making is not there that we saw last week on this Horned Frog defense. I mean, they're not close enough proximity to make the physical plays that this system demands, because they're playing man 80% of the time. That means you're on an island, and it's about making those one-on-one matchup and one-on-one plays. Just haven't seen it. The sure tackling is missing.
So much of last week was about raw emotion, and being on the road makes it difficult. This one is caught. It's a slant. It'll go. It's a touchdown, Blaine Green.
Been there all season.
First touchdown for Blaine Green this year, 46 yards, the strike.
Well, again, whether it's wide seam or the back, anyone they put out in that position, Tim, versus man coverage, is going to have an opportunity for a vertical shot. Those shots have been there throughout this series and the previous series. I was just wondering when Mike was going to get back to his old school days and get vertical to start throwing it a little bit. You've used the run effectively to set it up.
44th career touchdown pass for Sanders, 14th this season.
Spencer Sanders seen Blaine Green with that vertical route. His eyes are upfield. He knows he's got it. He's just got to put enough touch on it underneath to get it in his hands. Makes an easy catch. Green seats it well and then gets vertical and just outruns the coverage. It's a wonderful job of a quarterback who's now settling into his sweet spot. And they're green with envy on this Oklahoma State Cowboys offense.
Davis will bring it up. Stop shy of the 25. Well, Spencer, we've got a newbie in the big chair back in Los Angeles tonight.
Hey, now.
The wonderfully talented and Emmy Award-winning Emmanuel Acho tells us what's coming up on the State Farm Halftime Show.
Coming up on the State Farm Halftime, Oklahoma goes down in Waco, opening up the door atop the Big 12. Tennessee, well, they do something nobody's done against Georgia this season. And Ohio State, boy, did they light up the scoreboard against Purdue. Tim and Spencer, it's back to y'all.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Acho.
You see that southern yowl in there?
Yellow yowl.
Absolutely.
In there.
How about it? Look out.
I wonder what he's going to do. I wonder what he's going to do with those Texas-Kansas halftime highlights.
I know that's a low blow.
That one was good. That's a pass.
This is forward. It was forward by at least 2 yards at least.
Yeah. Fans reacting because there was no signal by the officials until a little bit late. Tay Barber dropped it. It'll be 2nd and 10. Is that something, though, what's going on with Sark? I mean, you talk about a huge story in college football.
Tim, it really is, but I'm just really shocked that people don't understand the connection between how you handle players and how they perform for you on Saturdays in this case. Yep. It makes a big difference, man.
I mean, Charlie Strong got fired because he lost to Kansas. Let's not lose sight of that. Second and 10. DeMarcado up to the 31.
Oklahoma State and Jim Knowles will concede these types of yards when you're got a significant, comfortable lead, Tim.
Third and 4. TCU with a couple of timeouts. I mean, they have to convert this play. And if they do, maybe they could get a little something going before halftime.
The ebb and flow. It's about pace and tempo. And the way to do it, you got to possess the ball appreciable amount of times and get the shots that they need to get on track.
Cowboys defense has just been all over them since late in the first quarter. The same is true here. That's a curious call to me. That's a big time stop by Antoine, 95, the senior from Oklahoma City. But I didn't understand that call.
Again, I've been thinking they needed to take a shot because you're not going to run the ball. I mean, this team right here is averaging right 2.8 yards they're giving up on defense per carry. That is paltry. I don't care. And you're down to your one back. You, as a tandem when this year started, you had 4 quality backs from TCU. Now you're down to 1. You're not going to beat this flying around defense with Jim Knowles right now. They've got them dialed up and dialed in big time.
I mean, TCU does get the ball to start the second half.
Oklahoma State, again, first of the half. This is a 30-second timeout.
Still, only 3 to get. That surprised me. Three, and on 4th and 2, Jordy Sandy, who's been pretty busy tonight, will boot it away to Brendan Presley, and we've got a false start.
False start, number 13, offense. 5-yard penalty, 4th down.
That was D. Winters, number 13. They got him. Guy's just not disciplined right now.
Spencer, think about this for a second. Breece Hall had a game-winning touchdown just a few weeks back against Oklahoma State. Mm-hmm. The Cowboys' defense has not given up a touchdown in 10 straight quarters.
I'm telling you, man, outside of Georgia, this is the best defense. The special teams ain't bad either.
Yeah. Markers down. Now Sandy went down.
Yeah, this is unfortunate. Oklahoma State's going to get called for penalty here for running into the kicker, but to me it was the penetration that they got to get there, which is something you ought to be concerned about if you're the opposition. You can see again everybody's trying to release to get downfield, but
personal
look how many
foul.
Black jerseys around the
roughing
punter.
The kicker, number 11 of the receiving team. 15-yard penalty results in an automatic first down. We'll have one on time down.
Well, this is the first time I've gotten to say this is the we have an untimed down coming after the penalty, so they can't end the half can't end on a play like that. So we'll have one more play coming. There may be a chance here for a little heave before we go to the intermission.
Well, this would be the situation where you got to throw it, man. Right? I mean, it would be a head scratch if they didn't take a shot here.
Yeah. But we talked about the defense. It's very rare when you open a broadcast talking about a team's overall defense, but Oklahoma State certainly deserved that coming in.
Absolutely, and this half has done nothing to take away from that decision to go with them in the 4. This defense has been outstanding.
See if Morris can get it out there, although they'll go underneath instead. And Watkins is spun down. Well, this is the first time I've gotten to say this. Emmanuel Adjo, Devin Gardner, and Bruce Insider Numbers Feldman. It's time for the State Farm Halftime Show. Gentlemen, how do you do?
Quite the introduction. Well, welcome in to the State Farm Halftime Show. I'm Emmanuel Acho. That's my guy, Devin Gardner, and Bruce Feldman. Well, Jalen Warren, he has been putting on a show. 3 touchdowns in the first half alone, and that is where we'll focus our halftime highlights. Sponsored by State Farm. Bruce?
Yeah, the thing that jumps out to me, when you watch this guy, such good balance. Even his own teammates can't knock him off track. But what's interesting is, earlier in the season, he had a stretch of 4 games where he averaged 32 yards a carry. The last couple of weeks, they've dialed him back, and they are feeding him tonight. And man, he looks fresh.
Yeah, I mean, Jalen Warren has been special. The first time I got a chance to see him was against Tulsa in spot duty, but he had some electrifying runs of 1 or 2 or 3 yards and sometimes losses. And I'm just like, this guy has something special. And then you see as the season continues to move on, they give him the ball a lot, and he's playing extremely well. And 7.4 at the half. I mean, that's a lot of.
Oklahoma State looking special. Oklahoma earlier today, not so much.
Guys did a wonderful job with a lyricist on that. I got the theme. Okay, all right, Oklahoma City. I got that. The band Mo, not Mo of the Three Stooges. It's the band Mo, ladies and gentlemen. Yep. We welcome you back, Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman. Well, Oklahoma State has been dynamite, but there have been key moments in the game, I'm sure, that have been your snapshots, Spencer.
Well, they have been my snapshot. It felt more like the Oklahoma land run back in 1889 or whatever it was.
You do know that history.
Absolutely. You may have been calling that. The game, actually, Jalen Warren and company. This is Blaine Green, though, right here. He did a wonderful job dripping with finesse on the screenplay after a couple of explosive way, and then Jalen Warren just did what he does well. On those green zone scenarios, 5 yards in, he's automatic, man. Number 7 on the dice. Every single time, ready to score, and then alternately the drops. Couldn't get anything offensively going big time on the other end. So again, once again, not able to get that prolific offense going like they had last week against Baylor in the upset victory. Man, I'm telling you, disappointing. But Timmy, I'll tell you what, in the end, there's always a second half and another opportunity, right?
Yes, indeed. And we'll see. TCU did defer, so they'll touch it first, and a fair catch is called for.
Timmy's second half connection is brought to you by AT&T Business. Keep your business connected with AT&T 5G. And it's all about the connection here. Talking about the blocking scheme, dripping with finesse, play away, action away, come back to Green. Nice job of laying it right in his hand. He does the rest on the back end. That's how you make the connection. Big fella's downstairs working for him. And here's the inside. Warren doing it on the other end, finishing. I'm telling you, this play in the script, the way it was laid out, was tailor-made for them to play and perform at the high level they did in this first half, Tim. Let's see if they can double up.
Horned Frogs will begin with Brent Matisic, the reserve tight end, now in at tailback, 42. And he'll lead on the jet sweep. Quentin Johnson, nothing doing. Is that you just cannot run sideline to sideline against Malcolm Rodriguez and the rest of these Cowboys. They will run and chase.
Maybe only Barry Sanders could do that. He's about the only one I know could get away from those guys. I mean, they do run and chase extremely well. 16 and 20, Timmy. That's a tandem right there. The sweep. Not going to outrun them.
Second down and 12. Matisic remains the setback. Same play to the other side. Same result. Only worse. Darius Davis dumped. This time it's Devin Harper, 16. Young man out of Knoxville, Tennessee, making the play. He was tremendous last week in that win over West Virginia. 8 tackles, 7 solos, a couple of sacks, and a forced fumble.
They work so well together at the snap of the ball. They got automatic green dogs, and what that means to him is when the guy that's supposed to be blocking stays in, he's automatically green dog or green lighted to go get after the quarterback, making plays on the other side of the line of scrimmage.
Third and 18. And it's Noel, 87, on the receiving end. And he's not able to get back to the 20 zone. On the first series, they go -7.
I can't say enough about the job that Coach Knowles has done with this stop unit, Tim. They have been active. They have been disciplined. They have dealt everything. They took everything that they saw last week against Baylor and basically shut it down. They're still looking for solutions.
Yeah, Jaden Trunigan, 42, making the play there. And they are so deep, Spencer. They'll go 3 deep defensively.
What was the mantra? We want to get old and stay old.
Yeah. Presley boots it away. High spiral. Fair catch is called. And they'll hold it at the 37-yard line. That's a 45-yard punt.
Ball is down with the Cowboys 37-yard line. They take over first down and 10. On the 44.
It's first down and 10, and the Oklahoma State Cowboys will bring it out. Spencer Sanders. First and 10 for the Cowboys as they look to exert themselves one more time here on their first series of the half. And that's Jaylen Warren ahead for a couple.
Tim, there's no reason for them to do anything. It didn't run the ball. Right now, this is not the same Horned Frog defense that we saw last week deal with Baylor's offense. So they can just run the clock out, shorten the game. And I just really believe that Mike Gundy's to a point now where he's comfortable winning this way. I wouldn't have said that 5 years ago, 3 years ago.
Well, it says a lot about Mike, and it's about winning. And again, he's ahead for another three or four. And they'll be 3 yards shy of the first down. You see the numbers on Spencer Sanders again, 14 of 21, 207, a touchdown. Very serviceable, and I think it says a lot about him. You know, he loves to run it himself, and he can also throw it. And I do believe he got ahead enough for the first down, and they'll have a chance to move the sticks here up to the 48-yard line. But it says Spencer, I think, a lot about Spencer Sanders. As you see, Jaylen is down on the field. Hope he's okay, so we'll take a timeout and check on him. That would be tough news indeed if he is injured to the point where he has to leave the game. And when we come back, we're going to talk to that man.
Yes, sir.
Not the statue, but the actual guy. So stay with us.
3, 2, 1.
Earlier today, here in Stillwater, for the very first time, a former player with a statue. And must say, Barry Sanders, I was here when you played. That had to be special for you.
I mean, it's such an amazing tribute, and just a wonderful honor for me and my family and teammates and everyone else. And it's really just hard to believe, honestly. But incredible, absolutely incredible.
How pleasant was it to have some of your teammates here with you, some of the guys that you labored with? Yeah. That had to be pretty cool, too, right?
Well, it was essential, and it was meaningful. The guys that I played with, they poured their blood, sweat, and tears onto the field as well, and they were so selfless, especially when I think about offensive linemen and the fullback and played with a great receiver named Hartley Dykes.
Oh, yeah.
And obviously Coach Gundy was the quarterback, so just phenomenal to have those guys here.
Hang with us, Barry. We want you to stay for a while. They love to run the football. You could help us out. As you see Desmond Jackson taking it ahead. The good news, by the way, when we get the break, Jaylen Warren was injured, but he did get up on his own power and make his way to the sideline. So we'll probably see a nice diet of Desmond Jackson, who had been on the shelf and has now come back from injury here in the second half, what with this comfortable lead that the Cowboys have. And frankly, Barry, they sort of went away from the power run game that Pat Jones had when you were here and when Thurman was here. But now this team is sort of a back-to-the-future club. That's Blaine Green, who had a very important catch, Spencer, that we documented at halftime in the first half.
Well, one of the things I want to ask Barry about is, again, how has the game changed? Because you had your heels, what, 7-8, maybe deep. And then in the spread era that we're in right now, I mean, everybody's so spread out. I can only imagine how many yards you would have accumulated in this era. Contrast and compare what you're seeing now versus what you were looking at years ago.
Oh, yeah, certainly. I mean, on the college level as well as on the pro level, you're seeing much more pass-oriented offenses. This year has been it's been fun for me to watch the Cowboys because they've had a terrific ground game. But certainly over the last 10 years, we've been airing it out here. And that's been our bread and butter. And that's the case with the game itself, but things often goes in cycles, this year we're running the ball again and having great success.
That was a beautiful catch by Tay Martin before the run by Jackson. I recall that team so loaded. 86, I came in here to do one of my first ever games in college football as a play-by-play guy. You were playing Missouri, Woody Woodenhofer's old team. It was icy, 30-something degrees in December, and Garrett Limerick was running back kicks. You were running back kicks in 86, and Thurman was the guy And but boy, oh boy, it changed. And you know what, Barry? I said this earlier, and I'll repeat it as we look at Spencer Sanders negotiate and talk about a good runner. He can do that too. Spencer, I know you love seeing that ball move to the left hand as he goes towards the boundary.
It didn't matter with this guy right here. You couldn't get to him, man. This guy's quick as a hiccup. And I use that analogy all the time in an ISO underneath. And Spencer does a great job. He's matured as a quarterback. But this is something that you got to do as a running back, right? The ball, put it on the boundary on the outside end so you don't get it, you know, snatched out of there. And that's part of the maturation of his game as we look at Foster, who goes down here.
Yeah, Josh is in need of a little help, so they'll take some time and tend to him. But that trip in 86 that I made in here, I had no idea that you were going to become what you did in 1988. But Barry, we've had this conversation, you and I, before. You were really the first Heisman winner that got promoted by the evolution of cable television.
Right.
CNN,
yes.
Sports Tonight, and my network at the time, ESPN, we bought satellite trucks, one satellite on top of a popsicle truck, to follow your games, because none of your games were televised until the Oklahoma game on ESPN.
Very last game.
Right,
yeah,
the very
last
game.
Regular season game. Absolutely. No, yeah, I mean, it was such a different era. You know, and obviously another reason we weren't on TV, because no one would have predicted, obviously, that I would end up winning a Heisman Trophy. You know, and the two front runners that year, Troy Aikman and Rodney Pete.
Yep.
You know, but
I bet
it was a phenomenal year.
I bet I know somebody that would have predicted it. And it was down the road in Norman, Oklahoma.
Yeah.
And hopefully we get a chance to tell you this story about Barry Switzer coming in and busting in our meeting, told Gary Gibbs, the defensive coordinator at the time, whatever you do, he said, Barry, just don't let that other one get in the game. Said,
is that right?
He wasn't scared of Thurman.
That story's true, right?
That's true.
That's true.
I was in the room.
Okay,
I heard.
All right.
Desmond Jackson gets it inside the 10-yard line, as only Spencer can impersonate Barry, right?
Oh, man.
Oh, boy.
He told Gary Gibbs, says, Gary, I tell you what, I've looked at the film, and whatever you do, you want to keep Thurman in the game, because you don't want that other fellow, because he's going to make us look awful. And he said some other choice words, but that was a seminal moment, man. We knew who you were.
Sanders has to unload it. But you know, talking about the technological evolution of the times, Troy and Rodney handled it with aplomb. You know, they kept saying during the course of the season, you know, there's this guy in Oklahoma.
Right of the
listen
pass.
To the call here.
Holding, number one, the defense. The penalty is half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
Hard to believe that's LaDainian Tomlinson's nephew. Hodges Tomlinson that was tagged with that penalty.
Almost got a natural pick underneath it. They've been going after them. I'm really shocked that they've gone after them as much as they have gone after them. They play a lot of man coverage in this Gary Patterson-influenced defense. They put a lot of pressure on these guys back here to cover. But when they come after you like that, man, it's going to test your manhood.
First and goal now with Desmond Jackson, the setback, out of the shotgun. Desmond, here's the push. Look out.
There you go.
Touchdown! You know, those offensive linemen of yours, I don't know that they ever pushed you like that.
I was going to say, Barry would have taken off about at the five. He would have taken off the five, just gone over the top.
They opened some nice lanes for me. I have to say that. They opened some nice lanes for me, so they didn't have to push.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. And as we watch this one play out, I got to tell you, Barry, I know you were so quiet and so humble even during the process back then, and you remained that way through your pro days. But I always understood how you deferred to your dad to promote you.
That's a nice way of putting it. That's a nice way of putting it.
Barry, this is what happened for you at halftime. It was a beautiful thing to see. Just savor the moment, my friend, and thank you for stopping by. We really appreciate it.
Hey, guys, thanks for having me, man. Always great to see you guys.
You are the greatest ever.
Absolutely.
I always know I'm doing something right when I see you guys. I always know that. I appreciate it, man. Great to see you.
Fox College Football is sponsored by Wendy's, official breakfast of NCAA football, and by Cadillac. As we mentioned a moment ago while Barry was here, the good news is Jaylen Warren is doing okay. He was walking walking around. He did sit down for a moment, but we think he's okay. He got up on his own power and was able to make his way to the sidelines. But he got a little nicked up. Everything looks good for the man that no longer needs a mullet. Boy, he loved handing off to Barry Sanders, I can tell you that.
He's just one of the greatest ones. And I can't remember who it was, if it was you or in a conversation we had recently. Barry Sanders saw the same thing as any other running back said. He could just get there where others couldn't. And that was really what separated him, his athleticism, his balance, the way he was built, squat to the ground, exceptionally quick, acceleration, converted speed to power. You know, I tell you what, I don't get awestruck when I'm around very many people.
Yeah.
But there are two running backs. One of them was Tony Dorsett, and the other one was Barry Sanders.
Yeah. I'm with you.
Different styles, but just elite.
And elite as a human being, too. Davis with the return out to the 32-yard line. Well, Ram Power. Players is brought to you by Ram Trucks, built to serve. And Jaylen Warren, Spencer's had some night.
Well, didn't matter where they moved him, he's going to be dangerous. And I think this has showed some of the creativity Casey Dunn did by moving him around a little bit to take advantage of those smaller athletic guys who are going to flow and give you an identification of where he plans to go. But even when you shut him down, penetration, not a problem. Particularly when you get in the green zone. Warren is going to be hell-bent for election, and he's going to get in there and score. This guy is invaluable. They need to make sure he's healthy as they work down the stretch here because he's going to be critical to their success long term.
Remember Oklahoma State next week, and we'll be there for it. Quick slant thrown behind the intended receiver, Blair Conright, who, by the way, had a big game last week. That's, I think, the first time he's been targeted tonight. It falls incomplete. Texas Tech is coming off a huge win, and they really helped Oklahoma State because a tiebreaker in head-to-head, had they wound up in a tie with the Cyclones, would have gone to Iowa State because they beat them head-to-head. Well, they're out of the mix now, thanks to Texas Tech. They held on, got a 62-yard game-winning field goal to win it. And next week, the Cowboys travel to Lubbock to take on this resurgent team with a new head coach. It's ironically a former linebackers coach with Baylor, while Sonny Cumbie is, for the time being, the interim head coach. That was Marcel Brooks on the receiving end of that pass. This is a third down and short. You see the problems on third down for Doug Beecham's club. They really need to give their defense a break.
Well, they do, Tim, but the problem is they've never established a run game, so you don't have to deploy numbers. They're going to be in a three-man front with one guy up vertical, and so that tells you what they think about their run game.
They just run out of bodies there.
Mm-hmm.
That wheel route is incomplete and well covered, too. Trying to get it to DeMarcado, but it'll be fourth down. Malcolm Rodriguez just peeled back there from linebacker. Stayed right with him, and that's a frustrated Doug Beecham.
Yeah, and that tells you what they think. If you got a linebacker, this is technically an inside linebacker Doug Beecham is looking at, able to peel off and match up with your running back or receiver. That shows you how athletic Jim Knowles' defense is. These are exceptional athletes on this team. They're disciplined. That makes them even more resolute and dangerous, Tim, as a group.
It's amazing what happens when a defense can make an offense one-dimensional.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, in effect, what's happened tonight.
No question, and that's exactly how you have to frame it, because if I can determine 50% of the time what you're going to do, I'm at a decided advantage. Flag down.
I think it's a delay of game.
Delay of game, number 31, offense. 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Gonna have to do it again. That was a good punt, too.
You know, Tim, back to your point about making it easier for defensive coordinator. You know, all good defensive coordinators got to know two things. You got to know your personnel and the situation. And when you're in constant third and long, man, that makes a job easier for you to call and dial up pressure.
Sandy will try it again. Equally good punt here. And a fair catch by Presley. At the 22. 8:03 remaining in the third. Cowboys looking to maybe garner a few style points. Even I hate having to say that. But it's the system we're living with, folks. Fox College Football is sponsored by Discover. Discover something brighter. Dominic Richardson is coming to the game. You look at this Oklahoma State offense tonight, 410, and that's above average for a normal evening for them. Controlling the game on the ground and allowing their defense to stuff the opponents. Sanders will set himself free and slide in safely at the 30. They made marking back at the 28.
Yeah, Colt Edison had a chance to stop him again. Shows you some of the elusiveness that Spencer Sanders still has and is at this late stage of the game. He's still trying to make and create plays. Edison had him dead to rights. Unbelievable job of smartly sliding at the end of it. He's just so elusive, man. This is part of the maturation of his game.
Yeah, and his memory has gotten a lot better. Mm-hmm. That's something that Casey Dunn talked to us about. He used to let some issues get to him. Now he's allowing a bad play to go away. So just a little amnesia can help. And he dumps that one under pressure with D. Winters coming right up the gut. And he got outside the tackle box and dumped it away.
Yeah, they move D. Winters from his Mike linebacker position, which is usually inside. Nice little tricky adoption and a little move there to create a different pressure look. So Spencer wasn't able to see where that pressure came from until late.
Tim Rattay has been his quarterback's coach, yep. And they've credited him quite a bit. Played for the 49ers, as you know, and a Louisiana Tech star back in the day. Here he goes again, trying to get to the line to make. I think he may have. Just past the 32, move the sticks.
Just so mindful of where he is and what he's trying to do. He's really taking care of the ball as he's trying to extend and make plays. He's just in a different level versus where he was 2 years ago. The maturation process has been constant, steady, impressive.
Richardson remains the setback. There you see he did get the line to make. Mm-hmm. At the 33. Pressured again. Up near the 40 before he's tripped up by Dylan Horton. I don't know how much longer Spencer will see him, though, because with what lies ahead, not only next week, a tougher take than maybe we thought a few weeks ago at Texas Tech, then you've got Bedlam. And who's to say that you won't have either Bedlam 2.0 or a repeat matchup with the Baylor Bears?
Well, it's less
in the championship game.
You're right. It's less of a factor than it would have been, except for what happened today, the outcome of the Oklahoma game.
Yep.
But, you know, listen, style points are matter, man.
They do. And that's a lot of style. Dominic Richardson. They had a mini Earl Campbell thing going on there for a moment. Shadrick Banks, who had the interception last week to close out the upset against Baylor, finally hauls him down 28 yards.
The physical,
for number 20 here.
The physical finish. D. Winters caught the brunt of that. It was a chilly reception. He went down, yeah. And he continued to move on, man. Just a wonderful job of combining vision and the finish and the physicalness.
That looked like Earl Campbell going up against Isaiah Robertson of the Rams. Remember that play?
Oh, yeah. Hit him square in the chest plate.
Indeed. Richardson to the 25. T.J. Carter making the stop. And for those of you too young to remember that, watch NFL films. Google it.
You know, we've been giving accolades to a lot of folks here, but Charlie Dickey, the offensive line coach, Timmy, has done a wonderful job.
Sure has.
With this group right here, just ushering them into this new era. It's not spread in terms of throwing it. It's about being physical.
Well, Spencer, all offensive linemen love
run blocking.
Yes, they do.
Got to do it.
Richardson again. Saving tackle by Hodges Tomlinson. And what they've done, Spencer, is by getting the ground game blocking going, they've become better pass blockers as a result.
They really have. And again, I kind of keep going back to this, the blocking up front. Again, the ISO, the look, the play action away, the nice vision to bounce it outside Van Zandt, trying to get there. Nice little hold on the outside there. You know, that was Tyrese Williams holding with that arm out of Cypress Ridge. But you know what? It doesn't take away from the scheme and what they're trying to do. We talked about Mike Gundy being a schemer. Offensively, this is brilliant what we're seeing tonight.
This has been Dominic Richardson's drive. He just has replaced Jaylen Warren, but he's doing the exact same thing. A Kendrick Van Zandt comes up to make the tackle for TCU.
And even when it's not executed cleanly, they still are integrating some what we call sift motion with whoever the up back, whether it's Dominic Richardson or any of the tight ends that may be in that role. They are executing at a high level right now in the run game, shortening the game, taking time off the clock.
Look at those yards.
Yep.
Total domination. Mm.
And those 70 yards are the exact number that the opposing quarterback had in the run game for his team.
Sanders. He got popped pretty good there at about the 2-yard line. D. Winters shoved him out. And this is my point. I don't know that this is going to be his last drive, but I would highly recommend it. He's getting popped here.
Watch him freeze Cole Anderson right there. Yep. Cole Ellison, number 44, thought he had him dead to rights. And the foot speed of Spencer Sanders shown on that play. It's another asset that he has in his little quiver of tricks.
And I mentioned this, Spencer, because there's a history of his being injured. Richardson, touchdown. There go the fireworks.
Timmy, you talk about taking your manhood. This is what it is. It's just basically a zone and a cutback opportunity for Richardson. And physically, they're just playing all the Cowboys of Oklahoma State faster than the Horned Frogs are right now. They are physically wearing them down.
We knew coming into this game it would be hard emotionally for TCU to back up what they did a week ago. But once their defense really turned their offense, TCU's, into a one-dimensional offense, it was game, set, and match. You name the number, all of them a little Barry-esque behind that offensive line. Fox College Football is sponsored by Ram Trucks, built to serve. Let's go down to Chris Economaki in the pits. I believe it's the center car, Spencer.
Yes, by nose.
No trouble in turn four because there are no turns. Did not pass inspection either, so we don't have to worry about it. Young man got a nice trophy. Darius Davis with the return. High steps his way out of bounds. An intelligent move on his part. Now, the Horned Frogs, we had mentioned that Max Duggan might have an opportunity to get in tonight, but it will be Chandler Morris. I thought what Coach Kill told us about Max early in the week, he walked in and said, you know, I think I'll be able to dress, Coach. He said, I know you will. I want you ready. He said, no. He said, look, this is his team now. You got to play that guy. You know, what great teammate that is. Max Duggan is a big-time talent with a great speed and size to go with his speed.
And Max obviously has got tremendous foot speed, and he's an athlete, he's a competitor, all of that stuff. I was shocked that that was the response. I'm not going to question it.
Yep.
But this is the competitive part of me. You never want to get in a game to the detriment of your team, necessarily, right. But I just thought that was a tremendous character move on his part.
Tay Barber with the reception for the first down. They get it out to the 31. A little different against this defense, and he knew it would be. He knew the size and strength that they had. But I'm going to tell you, there's a lot more in his game that TCU fans will be able to see over the next couple of weeks.
Well, like I said, and I stand by this in our open to the show tonight, that he is a solution. He's not a spark. That's right. Not what he is. This kid, he has the patina of something special, and I wouldn't bet against him.
His dad, Chad, we told you we chatted with him as he loops one incomplete. A little mix-up that time with Marcel Brooks. So it goes incomplete. We talked to him. When Chad Morris was fired from Arkansas, he was ready to get out of the business altogether. And they had a Sunday night gathering back in Dallas when Chad had been fired. And he said, you know, I think I might be getting out of this. There's a marker down, so let's check it. Hang on 1 second here.
Nope. Intentional grounding. Intentional. Number 14, offense. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Loss of down. Third down.
I don't see that either.
I don't know how you insert or somehow predict what he intended to do. It was a miscommunication between the receiver and the quarterback.
Exactly.
It's not intentional, bro.
That was an awful call.
Wow.
Anyone could see that he went one way. The pass was thrown in that particular area. I realize that the officials don't take communication in mind, but that should not have been grounding. And he overshoots Tate Arbor this time. I want to complete that story, Spencer. He actually told his dad what his dad used to tell him. When you face adversity, don't flinch.
Yep.
And so when his dad talked to both he and his sister about getting out of the business, not sure where he wanted to go, what he wanted to do, he said, "Dad, you've been telling me all my life, don't flinch." Well, don't flinch. You need to get back at it. And then he went on to join Auburn with Gus Malzahn, his old friend. And, of course, that didn't last long. And he wound up at Allen High School. They won last night 59-30, by the way, beat Hebron. So he's back in Friday Night Lights for a while. But, Spencer, I would suggest that he's going to be back in college coaching again real soon.
No question. I think that was only temporary. When you get gut punched like that in a relatively short window like he did, I can understand how your dauber gets down. But once again, man, the beautiful thing of imparting the wisdom that he did in his kids, they turn around and regurgitate it and give it right back to you. And that was inspiring to me to hear him tell us that story.
It was. Jerry Kill.
Yep.
Tough task tonight after what happened a week ago. And, you know, he was once in this area, was actually very much a part of Mike Gundy's upbringing in football and in life.
Yep. They went to school at a school right not too far from Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma City, Midwest City. The Bombers.
Desmond Jackson is back in the game. Spun down after a pickup of two. That's Dylan Horton with the tackle, number 98.
Tim, sometimes in sport you experience those ebb and flows that are significant like this, one end of the spectrum, great success, upset, and then you experience something like this on the road. All of it's character building. In fact, I've never learned as much in victorious situations I have when I've lost. And so this is a great learning lesson for everybody, one of these Horned Frogs that are here tonight.
Yep.
We're going to learn something from this.
Desmond Jackson gets ahead for another first down. No better man to be in this situation, though, for TCU, albeit for a brief time, than Jerry Kill.
Well, he's been through it six different occasions, and again, he's got the perfect countenance to come in behind and to really the perspective to do exactly what needed to be done. You talk about a great example of a situational leadership scenario. I'd like to study this one right here and pick his brain some more. He gave us a lot of good nuggets.
Sure did. Jackson one more time. Bradford with the tackle.
Yeah, it's starting to get a little bit chippy down
here.
It is.
Yep.
Starting letting those hands fly a little bit.
No one wants to get their noses rubbed in it. By the way, speaking of that, I know there were some that thought, speaking of noses being rubbed in it, that maybe Dave Aranda was doing that at the end of today's game between Baylor and Oklahoma.
Smart move his part.
Yeah, we need to touch on that. This pass. Yeah, mark or down.
You know, they have really been after that corner.
Yeah,
Hodges Tomlinson all night long. And you cannot argue with the strategy because
there are two fouls on the play, both by the defense. Offside, number 11, that penalty is declined. Pass interference, number one, that's a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic, first down.
Kyrie Coleman offsides, and Hodges Tomlinson with the PI.
Yep, he's got the right hand on the breastplate, and again, head down and not even making an effort to get back and look at the ball. And he's showing that surprise thing, but that's just more window dressing. They worked him over on that play.
Time winding down here in the third quarter. 42-3. It was 28-3 at the intermission. Quick out. John Paul Richardson, who had a big catch earlier. breaking tackles.
Yeah, T.J. Carter took a big shot there, man. Weak safety, Tim, came up and tried to make the play. Number seven, Richardson, wonderful job of navigating, but Carter, big stinger when he comes up, and you can see it's a very physical hit, and you knew it immediately. He's got his shoulders, got him lined up. Once again, these guys got to be careful about keeping their heads up, man. I know that was a shoulder, but the helmet-to-helmet contact is something you got to be careful of, and that would be insult to injury. But
yeah, and they need everybody they can get to the finish of this season. And they've run out of bodies tonight, that's clear. No scholarship running backs past Amari DeMarcado has been part of their problem. One of the reasons why Oklahoma State could just sell out and say, you know, you got to beat us throwing it because you're not going to run on us.
Yeah, and you don't even have the threat of the run game, and that's just it. Because, again, part of success on the defensive side is understanding the personnel. Once I see your personnel and the down and distance, man, I can get what I need. It's going to give me the best chance of winning the series.
This has been some Cowboy coronation tonight. I'd say they're setting themselves up beautifully, not only for this fourth quarter, but for what lies ahead. It could be a Big 12 title. A Big 12 championship opportunity. Dare I say, the Invitational at the end. Fox College Football is sponsored by Ram Trucks, built to serve. Ethan Bullock has come in at quarterback as we open play here in the fourth quarter for Oklahoma State. Jackson, and TCU responds.
D winners.
Yep, and I think a great idea to get Sanders out of the game.
And that may ultimately chase some of the blues away from this one frog defense.
Yep.
Big plays like that allow you a chance to kind of tee off a little bit.
Spencer, the last time a Big 12 defense went 11 straight quarters without allowing a touchdown was West Virginia 2015. Last time a Big 12 team went three straight games without giving up a touchdown, Kansas State, in 2006. Yeah. Bullock at quarterback. And there goes Jackson. Action Jackson. Gets it down to the one. And, you know, a guy that's been out like that, you know, Spencer, he is so lathered up and ready to go. Jackson's numbers in this game really picking up to go along with Dominic Richardson, who was toting it in the last series.
They're going to accommodate him and just go tempo a little bit, and the quarterback is even going to get in there and help him push.
He's very close. It has no signal yet.
There's going to be another flag
here. Yeah, and a late flag.
These guys are just getting a little bit too chippy. D Winters and company on the back end.
Right.
Have really got to contain themselves.
Jackson, by the way, has 69 yards on the ground on 12 carries and a touchdown. And that's another reason you get that guy on the sideline as it gets chippy in the fourth quarter. There's a flag down. This kid can stay upright, Spencer, through the regular season. I think the Cowboys are in great shape in terms of making the Big 12 conference championship game. Again, what happened earlier today in Lubbock with Texas Tech and Iowa State takes the Cyclones out of the mix. It's really a three-team race now.
The result of the play is a first down. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 97 of the defense. This penalty being forced half the distance to the goal with an automatic first down. This is number 97's first unsportsmanlike penalty of the game.
And, Tim, I'll add something to that thought. I mean, we said this 2 weeks ago, and people thought I was crazy. I said this was the best defense, not named Georgia, in college football. But I think that this Oklahoma State team is probably best suited should they get to the championship game to do better in the postseason because of the way they're built.
No question.
They're built more like an SEC team.
They are.
Than Oklahoma was.
They really are. You know, the funny thing is the Big 12 was so maligned because of the defensive issues. As there you see Jackson in for the touchdown.
That's genuine happiness right there from that offensive line that got Jackson in to score. Again, just because they're up, man, they are so invested in the success. And as you pointed out earlier, Tim, run blocking, that's defining the character of this team.
Second touchdown of the night for Desmond Jackson, and this blackout crowd is enjoying the proceedings, and a great number of them are still here. 49-3. Fox College Football, sponsored by Pacific Life. More than 150 years strong, protect what matters most. This is just one beautiful campus. And Spencer, I don't know of another campus in this conference that has improved more over the last 35 years than this one. It's just beautiful. Boone Pickens has to be smiling up above for all that he did for this university. You look at the standings. Oklahoma now has a loss. Cowboys will move into that spot right there with them in the loss column. Baylor still very much alive, in need of a little help. And then you worry about tiebreakers. How does that fall? Moving on. The Iowa State loss today, significant. And especially for Oklahoma State.
Yeah, we need at some point to go back and unpack what you began earlier after we do this business here.
Yep. Pacific Life Game Summary is sponsored by Pacific Life. More than 150 years strong. Protect what matters most. And this baby was toast, really, right after Oklahoma State continued to feed this man.
Jaylen Warren is outstanding, man. He just showed you. Then Green came in and complimented him extremely well. Jackson and company, that trio, man, became exactly what TCU had before the season began. Three solid runners, four all told, that contributed to the outcome of this score right now. No matter what happens, the narrative this one will be total domination for three complete quarters.
That's Sam Jackson in at quarterback, the young man out of Naperville, Illinois.
Wow.
And he finds number four, Tay Barber, all the way down to the 12-yard line. Jackson is the 5'11 freshman from Naperville, Illinois, just outside Chicago, that Doug Meacham was talking to us about prior to last week's game.
And we had the impression that he may get some time, but it didn't work out that way. Morris obviously lit the place up, but Jackson shows you he's got a nice, beautiful ball.
You think?
Yeah, absolutely. And got it downfield in the hands of a guy that really hadn't played exceptionally well to this point, Tay Barber. But boy, with that ball, it's hard to drop it.
62 yards, the strike. So a little hello, how do you do,
oh, man,
from the kid from Chicago.
Time
we actually were surprised.
Malfunction with the chains.
Yeah, they had to run down there pretty fast. Chains are down, so they're having an issue over there across the way on the TCU sideline. Might have to bring out the old WFL Dicker rod. I'm old enough to remember that. The old World Football League had something that looked like a compass, looked like this big compass to measure with.
That predates me, brother.
They called it, it was 1974-5.
Oh, yeah, I was.
Zonka and Warfield were playing.
My breath still smelled like Similac at that time.
Shreveport had a team, the Shreveport Steamer back then. I was covering them.
How about that?
DeMarcado, touchdown, TCU. Well, finally a touchdown. In what, 12 quarters? First touchdown scored against Oklahoma State's defense in 12 quarters.
And it took a big play from a guy that hadn't played. And again, it's that element of surprise, just like Morris had last week against Baylor. I think that has a lot to do with it, Timmy. Looking at the skill set of the guy, not being familiar with his game.
How about that? Meacham's over there congratulating Sam Jackson and the guys, living in the moment. Mm-hmm. What a thrill for that kid. And you may hear from him in the future. We've gotten to the point now, Spencer, where it seems with these 7-on-7s in the spring and summer, dual threat quarterbacks, and the proliferation of them, everybody's got two or three wonder kids on their roster. This is one of them. And DeMarcado knew what to do with the open lane right there. Mari DeMarcado has his place in history against Oklahoma State. 2 hours, 52 minutes, 52 seconds of game time. First touchdown given up. The last one in the fourth quarter, which turned out to be a game winner for Iowa State in Ames. Fortunes of Iowa State certainly went the other way after that W, and for Oklahoma State, it only made them better.
Yep, it sure did. And again, I think everybody's going to have selective memory about this game. It's going to be for three quarters, and the replacement players enter.
Yeah, you know, Gary Kill and Mike Gundy go a long way back. Kill coached Gundy in high school for a year, 37 years ago, and was his biology teacher. And he said, he and I have been able to stay in touch through the years. He's done a lot in his career. He's said all the right things. And there you see the picture of the 84 Midwest City High School team.
I love what he said when you asked him about what kind of a student was he. Yeah. He didn't show up to class very much. He didn't see him very much.
Don't send your cards and letters, yeah. Midwest City alumni to Gary Kill. I think he was just having some fun in jest. That's Dominic Richardson. But, I mean, it was a mutual admiration society, without question. Gundy feels the same way about Kill. And I think that the way he's gone about it, you know, the old school tough guy is what Gundy called Jerry Kill. And, you know, that power football brings some power and respect back to your team. Even during the spread era, you could do that. And that's exactly what Gary Patterson saw, was the reason why he asked him to join after he left Minnesota with his health issues and all that he went through with epilepsy. Ball's on the ground.
Down, yeah. How about the nice dip to
TCU. It's going to be a touchdown.
Colt Ellison
gets it in.
How about the nifty footwork by Colt? The scoop and the score. Watch Colt after the ball comes out. Bullitt's trying to seat it properly there. Just makes a bad decision and doesn't pull it out all the way. And Colt says, I'll take that and head the other direction. Nice little dippity-doo move there.
Absolutely.
Oh, nice.
The junior from Aledo, Texas, gets it in there for the touchdown. And the extra point coming from Griffin Kell. A little sloppy with some of the backups in there, which calms down some of this crowd, but Ellison will certainly take it. You got to find the joy, folks. It's still a game. They're still kids. 49-17. Jerry's pumped.
He's still coaching.
Absolutely. Ellison's been smiling from ear to ear since we went to the break.
See, they've been talking about his style point. The little dipsy do he did coming in there.
Absolutely.
Chopping it up, man.
Sort of like a guy coming off the bench and, you know, putting the ball on the deck before he hits a three-pointer. Like, right there. Whoop. You know, a little whoop.
Yeah, see, they talk about that in the room. So when you're in the room, you talk about the style on that, man. Athleticism.
Clear catch is called. Spencer, I call this Carnage Saturday, and we're going to see a lot more of it in the coming weeks. Georgia does get it done, but they give up 17. That's three more than they've given up all year to Tennessee. Alabama gets away with playing another FCS school in November. The entire SEC does that every year. No one says a thing. Oregon's playing Wazoo tonight. Important game. Ohio State blows away Purdue, but look down there, okay? Oklahoma loses to Baylor. Notre Dame takes care of Virginia, so you can't throw dirt on Cincinnati because Notre Dame is still winning. But everybody wants to throw dirt on Cincinnati. Dominic Richardson is in the backfield. He'll carry it here. He's ahead past the 30 to the 33. And just outside the top 10, Texas A&M is losing. That game is just about to wrap up in Oxford, so the Lane train is back on course and not out of it in the SEC West. 29-19 the score in that game. So between now and Thanksgiving weekend, we're talking about a November to remember. I think this could be the most carnage we've seen in November, where unbeatens and one-loss teams take it on the chin than maybe we've ever seen.
I agree with you, and I think it's apparent to you and I and anybody that follows the game, but there are two teams as we look at this.
Richardson. He's going to get up around 100 with that one.
Yep.
Look, Bradford hauls him down. But
just to close the thought out of the big run, it's a great hole, Timmy, a wonderful opportunity. And that's what these teams are doing as we get down the stretch. They're taking advantage of wide open opportunities, just running right past guys that are sticking in the hole, trying to find something to happen. Wyatt Harris, the Sam linebacker, just went right past him.
Marker down, pass is incomplete. Intended for Cale Cabanis, 37, the redshirt freshman from Norman. I remember a Cabanis at Oklahoma back in the day.
Carl Cabanis.
Gotta believe
offside,
they're related.
Number 99, defense. 5-yard penalty. Replay first down.
Maybe a third cousin.
Possibly. Not, it's not a common name. Cabanis
is not
a common name.
Not at all.
You know, just to finish that thought up, Tim, there are two teams in that list that you just showed a minute ago. It's Notre Dame and Cincinnati. Those are the ones I'm looking in tandem to follow how we treat them at large.
Exactly.
Because if you, it's going to be telling, man, to see what they do with them.
Yep.
Cincinnati haven't gotten that victory.
Who has a better road win in the top 10?
None.
Than Cincinnati?
Mm-mm.
Richardson. Yeah, the scrum continues. He's up over 100. He had 102 prior to that run, and he's out for about another 7 or 8. So that'll be about 110 on the night for him. And Oregon, here's the deal with them. If they can just keep winning, they'll keep, the committee will keep them where they are.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because they want to, you know, Ohio State is a brand name, a privileged team. They want to get them in there. But the same doesn't work for Michigan State that works for Ohio State.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because they lack privilege.
Mm-hmm.
Michigan State is not Michigan.
That's right.
Therefore, Michigan gets the call over Michigan State. So don't believe your lying eyes when dealing with a committee.
Now, they're higher up the ladder than, let's say, a TCU was in Baylor in 2014.
Yeah, yeah.
But your point is, it's a matter of degrees.
Yeah. I mean, Michigan got a great win today at Penn State. Had to come from behind to do it, and congratulations to Jim Harbaugh. Well, this Oklahoma State triple threat running back Richardson with 10 carries, 110 yards. Jackson has 68. Warren has 113. So they are stat sheet stuffing here in the late stages. 6 touchdowns between them. 6 different backs involved. Richardson again. And Spencer, I'll go back to this again on Oklahoma State, too. During all the conversation about Oklahoma ascending, okay, it's all in front of them, we hear, all in front of them. Well, is it not all in front of Oklahoma State?
It should be. If it applies for Oklahoma and they've had essentially a similar or comparable schedule, it should be all in front of them as well. And so we should have the same narrative, the same hype. Again, forget the monikers, all of that. It's about what you do. And that's the crazy thing about this committee, man. It's all about not projecting forward. Remember they used that narrative they used to talk about all the time?
Absolutely.
It's about how you are right now. What are you showing? And this Oklahoma State team is showing you nothing but scoring strength and capability, a solid defense, an elite defense. I'm telling you, man, outside of Georgia, I don't see anybody better than them in the nation.
Richardson carries it in for the touchdown. So 3 running backs now with multiple touchdowns in tonight's game. Richardson now with 2 to go along with Warren's 3 and Jackson's 2.
I love how they cut off the backside with their tight ends, and they slipped a lot of different personnel in there to cut off the backside pursuit for those inside zone reads. And another scheme, another way of handling things that Mike Gundy has adapted to. Beautiful job.
Alex Hale this time will try the point after. Right through the middle. Well, when you hang half a 100 in a conference game, you feel pretty good. When you got 3 backs, 2 of whom had 100 plus and another with 70, that's a pretty good night, privileged or not. Fox College Football is sponsored by AT&T Business, keeping your business connected with AT&T 5G. 56-17. Well, these running backs have been thoroughbreds tonight. Dominic Richardson with 131. 113 for Warren. He left the game after getting nicked up a little. Probably the major concern might be, is he going to be healthy and good to go next week? moving forward, the Cowboys. And that went through the end zone for a touchback. All right, so Jake Jolivet, our producer, is going to play a little Who Are We? Famous Broadway musical duo, Tony Awards, Academy Awards, Pulitzer Prizes, Grammy Awards, most famous musical, Oklahoma, where the wind comes whipping down the ring. That's got to be it, right? That's got to be Gordon McRae or Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Rodgers and Hammerstein. Well,
there you go.
Let's face it.
That's right.
I was gonna go all Shirley Jones and Gordon McRae on you. By the way, not only did I love that musical, I'm a big musicals guy. As you know, I could have been in theater. But I also loved the Carousel. Remember Carousel? Oh, I love that. Had a deeper meaning. Shirley Jones and Gordon McRae were in that as well. Or was that Howard Keel? Might have been Howard
Keel. Well, I used to love to watch the hawk making lazy circles in the sky.
Yeah.
Lim and I sitting on the back porch.
Yeah, yeah. All the leading men back then were really short. Gordon McRae was short. Alan Ladd was short. Always, you know, it's. I think it was because the cameras needed them to be about the same height as the ingenue. Okay? Here's Sam Jackson in some trouble, and he'll go down. Jolivet thought he had us there, but to no avail.
Nope. I mean, I posted something on Twitter last week, and I sang the whole Oklahoma song, man.
Doug Meacham still sending out those signals. Tough night for Chandler Morris, but I think he'll grow from it, and I think TCU, Spencer, still has a lot of good left in their season. I really believe that. Mm-hmm. I think tonight is a bit of an aberration. They ran into a buzzsaw that happens to be a lot better than even a lot of college football people realize.
Well, I can tell you this, Jackson included in this group, and this guy's got running back in him or anything else. He's an elite skill, dual threat type guy. But with Morris, he's going to be a catalytic kind of player that allows Doug to get back into his wheelhouse as a play caller and start to really release some of those gifts and talents. I mean, he's probably one of the elite disciples of the air raid, you know, era. And then I think that obviously the father of it all is Mike Leach. And if you want to go back before then, you can talk about Miles Davis and some of those other guys, mm-hmm. John Jenkins, and June Jones, and all those guys, man.
But I got to tell you, of all those guys, Miles Davis was ahead of the curve in a mm-hmm. lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
I got to cover him in the USFL when I was just starting out, and so much of what the run and shoot was about is exactly what the spread game evolved into. That's Nixon with a fair catch.
A lot of the same choice route concepts.
Yep. Time now for our moment of the game, sponsored by the new Coca-Cola Zero Sugar. Could it be the best Coke ever? This guy is, if not the best ever, the best of his generation. The statue. I've got to believe that this had to be even bigger than the statue, though. Right next to Thurman to see that happen. Fireworks. And then probably the proverbial cherry on top, right? Spence would.
That's what he told us. He's hanging with us, man.
Yeah, come up and spend a little time with Spencer T and Timmy B.
Well, no, seriously, though, I remember a couple of weeks ago when we were here. Is this Gunner in the game?
It is. Gunner Gundy is coming to the game at quarterback.
How about that? Coach's son. Yeah, he's got some skill. We've been following him since he was in junior high school, man.
Well, by the way, Gunner's been giving advice to his dad as long as Chandler Morris has been giving advice to Chad Morris.
Mm-hmm.
And he would tell us about it during meetings when Gunner was in high school. Of course, his younger brother is doing just the same now in high school. And this kid is a prospect. Okay?
Legitimate prospect.
The fans have been chanting, "We want Gunner," for the last 20 minutes. Well, you got it. Jaden Nixon is in the backfield. Nice move. And he's ahead past the 35 to the 37-yard line. Now, here's the question. Will Dad let his son chunk it? Will he let him chunk it?
Well, you know what? He's going to protect him, but I guarantee you, if he moves the ball down the field, he finds himself in a scenario where it warrants it. I don't see why not.
Yeah. I hope he does, but we'll have to be mindful of his relationship with Jerry Kill. But we'll see. Third down and four. Nixon remains in the backfield with a little help from the H-back. Why throw it when you can do that? Why throw it when Jaden Nixon can do that? How do you do? 63 yards.
Timmy, I held back. I was going to call this one, but on the left side, you'll see it in the setup where the void is on the left side of that line. You just run where the bodies aren't. The Horned Frogs kind of reduced or moved down late, but the hole was right there, man. He just found it, sifted, stayed tight to it. Patrick Jenkins and company tried to stop him off that defensive tackle, number 91. Just couldn't get to him, man. Showing you spinning balance, vertical speed.
Ellison was the only one, 44, that had a sniff at getting a tackle. After that, he was gone. Hale with the extra point. Eight rushing touchdowns by the running backs. Last time we've seen this many in Stillwater, 9-1, September 1 of 2012 against Savannah State. Oklahoma State's remaining schedule in Lubbock. Spencer and I will have it next week on Fox. You don't want to miss it. Texas Tech's coming off a big win at home against Iowa State. And then Bedlam. Could it be a precursor of Bedlam 2.0? Baylor may have something to say about that, given the fact they have the tiebreaker against the Sooners. Davis, after a cue ball bounce, decided to bring it up to the 15-yard line. Next week on Thursday Night Football, Mac Jones and the Patriots head to Atlanta to meet Matty Ice and the Falcons. It all starts at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on Fox, NFL Network, and streaming live on Prime Video.
Tim, if the Cowboys could get that win against Oklahoma as this future plays out the way it appears to be, then the element of recency comes into play, man. If you beat Oklahoma on their way out, this is the inflection point potentially for this program. And
They could ensure the fact that Baylor, were Baylor to win out, would be the opponent, not Oklahoma. Jackson.
He's fast.
Cam Jackson. Be really interesting what's going to happen, Spencer, in the next few weeks after this season is over in Fort Worth. I mean, it's a proud program. It's got a lot of revenue around it and within it. And the direction that they want to go in a head coach, well, that is the future. Jerry Kill understands that. He's in the role of caretaker at this stage. But moving forward with the facilities that they have and the ability to pay what they were paying Gary Patterson, well, a lot of head coach potentials out there, and they know how big and how great a job the TCU job will be. And I would submit that after LSU, USC in that order, that TCU would be the prominent next job in line.
Well, there's no question. I think they've spent in excess of $400 million over the last decade in facilities, and they're an elite program in terms of facilities concerned. A lot of NFL teams wind up using their facilities. Tim, they are plumb. When you go there, that place is about as posh as I've seen.
And Jackson in a world of trouble after the bobble. And he's going to do a little ad-lib job from the blacktops of Chicago, baby. Naperville, Illinois. He steps out at the 49-yard line.
That was some south side activity
there,
man. He was dodging big time.
But, look, it's a... we were there last week to watch all of this. Let's just take a look at this calamity that he was able to get out of.
Yeah, this is just all improvisation, Tim, and just running away from people and showing you that skill set that really separates him and what made Doug Meacham suggest to us that he may see some time when we saw them last week.
Amani Watkins is back in the backfield again, the converted cornerback. Normally would wear 22, but Conright has that same number, 22. So they had to change his number to 19 as he moved into the offense. That was a pretty big hit by Cobb. Third down and three coming up. I want to see him throw a seam route. You know, right?
He could throw it.
I'd love to see it.
You can, particularly now, he could throw it.
Going to keep it on the ground with Watkins. They haven't converted a first down since their first drive. And they converted third downs, I should say. Their third drive, they converted one. They have not been able to stay on the field to give their defense a break, and that added to their misery index tonight.
And that's really what the issue is. I mean, Oklahoma State didn't really change their game plan. They still kept it on the ground and still just wore out this smaller defensive front for TCU. And, you know, you can't really besmirch anything about the reputation of Mike and how he's managed this game. He just basically played football.
High boot. Sending Nixon back for the fair catch. Well, when we get Oklahoma State games, this is what can happen, right? Well, we did get a good game in between.
Mm-hmm.
We did get a good game in between. Next week, we'll be in Lubbock. I suspect that he knows, and we actually touched on this with this week's game, that his offense might have to have a few more explosive plays. And against Texas Tech, that may well be the case because the Red Raiders like to score quickly.
Well,
they really do.
Mike Gundy's got a lot that he can, you know, unfail here. He's basically just kept it in his back pocket because he hadn't needed to.
Yeah.
The defense has carried them, and that takes a lot of emotional discipline to do what he's doing. I mean, this guy is a throw guy. You know, every much as bit as Doug Beecham said that I am an air raid guy, Mike Gundy is the same thing.
No doubt.
And that he's not doing that and deferring to the run game, but to carry them is a lot.
That's why I made the Brian Billick comparison in the first half of the Ravens of 2000. You know, after all the success he had with Randall Cunningham and that record-breaking offense in Minnesota working for Denny Green, he goes to the Ravens. They got all these future NFL Hall of Famers on the defensive side.
Ray Lewis and
company.
Yeah,
he changed his tune, and it got him a Super Bowl. Nice. Great defensive penetration that time by Ellison.
Saw some elusiveness with Gunner, though.
Yep. I think the fans are just like a guy coming in to play basketball. They want to see him take a three, you know, just shoot one out there from about 30 feet. But I don't think that's going to happen here. Third down and five. Speaking of basketball, Spencer, I thought it was interesting that Mike went Oklahoma State, Henry Iba, Eddie Sutton.
Oh, he did the comparison, didn't he? Yeah.
About why he made the change that he made from an offensive standpoint. That's Andre Washington with the carry. He made the statement. He said, Eddie Sutton knew if I'm playing against guys that are quicker and faster than we are, I'm not going to travel up and down the floor with short possessions and give them the ball back. I want to use some of that clock.
That's basketball on grass right there, if there ever was a comparison, man.
Slowing it down.
You know, one of the lessons and the tenets of the game is the ball moves faster than the body.
Yeah, absolutely.
Spacing, right?
No question. We went all Iba Gallagher Hall on us there. I'll never forget the first time I walked into that arena for a game. And they had a wrestling match going on. The place was packed. Oklahoma State didn't need to wrestle tonight. They were dominant. This would have been one fall with no time limit necessary, and it would have been over. Their two old friends embrace at midfield, and they hang 60-plus on TCU. 63-17, the final. Spencer and I will come back to wrap it up in just a moment, close out what has been a very interesting day, to say the least, in November.